We have a board workshop, so we'll start off with item number four.
That's where we have to go through.
It's just a workshop, right?
You have to do the quorum and the public.
Yes, you have to establish a quorum and then ask if there's public comments.
Okay, yes, but, okay, never mind. So I call this meeting to order of the Sherland, hold on, a little minute. Okay, here we go. I call this meeting of the Sherland Independent School District to order. Let the record show that a quorum of board members is present and that the meeting has been duly called, and that notice of this meeting has been posted in accordance to the Texas Open Meetings Act, Texas Government Code, Chapter 551. Board members that are present today, we have Ms. Melissa Smith, Mr. Ricky Longoria, Mr. Keith Padilla, Mr. Hector Rivera, establishing a quorum, and myself, Pepe Garcia. So now we go on to item number three, public comments?
None.
None. We go to item number four, Jensen Elementary Star Books, presenter Dr. Arce.
We decided we're going to have the students do the presentation.
Okay, so you can introduce them to us,
PowerPoint.
Please.
Yes.
That's awesome.
Hello, I am Eileen Fossils. I am in sixth grade, and I am the Jesse L. Jensen City Council President. Hi, I'm Caitlin Rodriguez. I'm in second grade.
An awesome student council.
Jensen Starbucks Cafe. Welcome to Jensen. Jensen Elementary held its Starbucks Cafe grand opening on October 4th of 2019. Dr. Vidaudi and Mr. Garcia came to join us.
We take great pride in our Starbucks Cafe. Our library instills in us the love of reading.
We have these posters in our rooms. This way we know what goals are for each reporting period. We visit the Starbucks Cafe as much as possible to check out more books. We are excited to earn our AR points.
Book tasting and frappes. Students who earned their points got a frappe, attend book tasting for fiction, and received a free book.
Thank you to Barnes & Noble, Jensen's Pizza, and Black Iron Cafe. They donated a lot of books. We were able to book taste and pick the one we liked. There were realistic fiction, historical fiction, fairy tales. We had lots of choices.
reading is fun.
Awesome.
Yay.
Jensen Elementary Profit Shareholders. All students are responsible for monitoring themselves.
We take pride in being able to achieve our reading goals.
These are the final results for the first grading period.
In the 2018-2019 school year, Jensen ranked last year in AR in the district. This year, we came in third place for the first reporting period.
First reporting period, Starbucks profit shareholders. In first place, second grade with 78%. Second place, sixth grade with 76%. Third place, first and third grade with 72%. Fourth place, fifth grade with 67%. And fifth place, fourth grade with 60%.
Thank you so much
for your support. It wouldn't be possible without you.
Super adorable.
Were those frappuccinos caffeinated or decaf?
Decaffeinated. Yeah. We look both got the caffeinated.
Come this way so we can shake you all's hands.
Oh, yeah. I'm going to shake them.
Great job.
Super.
Amazing.
Great presentation.
Great presentation.
Great job.
Hey, I like your glass
skills. Can you come up to the front?
Yes, of course.
Just to brag on her, she's taking a college course in one of the universities in California for Disney-like animation.
Oh,
So I'm so proud of her.
That's gonna have to be a separate commission.
What do we want to do on the picture? Yes.
Can we do it up here?
Probably.
But you're not.
Come here, girls.
Come on.
Come on, Dr. Arcola.
On the count of three. One, two, three, two, three. Thank you so much.
Let me do one really quick. On three. One, two, three. One more time. One, two, three. I can.
Thank you, guys.
Amazing. Thank y'all.
Thank you.
Item number five, curriculum and instruction. We have a discussion of the 2019-2020 campus improvement plans. Ms. Montalvo?
Yes, good evening once again. I do want to let you know that our principals will be coming up and they will be giving you a 2-minute overview of their campus improvement plan. As you know, the campus improvement plans can be anywhere from 60 to hundreds of pages. So just like the district plan, they will be providing you with their campus initiatives and their areas of focus. We do have two principals that have prior engagements and I need to get on their way. So we're going to start off with Mrs. Pettis from Martinez Elementary, and then Mrs. Garza from SHS, and then we'll be giving out in the correct order.
Should we go from here?
Yes.
Sure.
Thank you, David. Cool. And David's setting the 2-minute timer.
Right.
Okay. I brought just some information. My aunt passed away on Friday, and so I'm going to her services right after this. So if you see me leave, that's the reason I'm leaving. But in case you have any questions, I just brought just our information just for a point of reference. So our campus initiatives for this year, we will provide teachers with ongoing guidance and support during our SISD planning and preparation days, which are after every 6 weeks. And so now what we're doing is we're being more intentional and we're going to the classrooms and actually planning with the teachers and looking at the way they're planning and then having them create the curriculum calendar. So we're being more intentional in that way. Students and staff will monitor performance after each CPA and benchmark utilizing the SISD student growth trackers. This year we did receive from our curriculum department student growth trackers, and so we have our own board where we're tracking our students, and then the students are tracking their own progress as well. So we're all focused on growth, and so we are monitoring after every benchmark and CPA. And then students who typically perform at the meets and masters level will be invited to enrichment camps on Saturdays during the spring semester for TEKS review and enrichment activities, and that will happen second semester. And so these are areas of focus, and this is the information that you have. We'll provide students with more opportunities to listen, speak, read, and write to increase CELPAS composite scores from 44 to 50. We did meet the CUT score last year for CELPAS. The CUT score was a 36 and we were at a 44. But of course, we always want to improve and show growth, so now it's at a 50. We want to improve attendance percentage from a 97.3 from previous year to 98 for this school year to continue meeting quartile one for distinction designations. The minimum score that the state set last year was 97. We were at a 97.3. We were very close to not meeting for attendance, and so that is one of our areas of focus that we're going to continue. And then the rest is increased growth points earned from a 66 to an 82 to receive an A rating for the 2019-2020 school year. The third grade master's performance in math and reading will increase from quartile 2 to quartile 1, and you'll see how much we need to grow from a 33 to a 32 in reading and 25 to a 30 in math. And then the last one is accelerated student progress in ELAR and math will increase from a 22 to a 30 in reading and a 29 to a 35 in math to meet the quartile one for distinction designations. We were at a quartile 2 and then quartile 3 in student progress for math, so we want to get those to 1. And so these are areas of focus in our initiatives for this.
Anybody have any questions?
Thank you.
And then.
Good evening, Dr. Nadali, members of the board, president. I'm ready to go. Here we go. I got something. I got the soul.
You go, Lori.
No, that's not me.
Oh, yeah, let's scroll down.
Turn it on. Okay, so the three initiatives that we picked for our campus, first and foremost, is going to be, in looking at our data, we figured that TELPAS was one area that we needed to provide emphasis on. So, in looking at that, it was more of the logistics and how we are actually providing the test of that day and the amount of attention that we're providing to TELPAS. So that's something that we, as a team, will be looking at, the scheduling, the collection, the reading of the writing samples, as well as the logistics of the online test. That's a big one for us this year. Number two, provide ample opportunities for students to earn industry-based certifications and to take the test in effort to bolster students the CCMR, obviously number two. And number three, an intentional focus on aligning curriculum, instruction, and assessment. And in detail, as far as the actual areas of focus, and going from CCMR, you know, we did have a big jump. We jumped from a 72, I believe, to a, no, 73 to an 82. So hopefully this year, it's like those last 10 pounds, right, 82 to a 90. Well, we'll see, we're gonna work it. And it's something that we're gonna focus on, but it's definitely something having to do a lot with the data processing and whatnot. So we're gonna work on that. The other thing would be increase the TELPAS progress rate from a 25 to a 40%. And to help with the curriculum department, I want to attribute that to them. That's something that they showed us. Hey, if you work on this certain area, you're gonna see this amount of growth. So again, we're doing that this year. Increase the percentage of students achieving mastery level. We like the distinctions, of course. So in algebra, we're hopefully going from a 44 to a 50, biology 26 to a 35, U.S. history 49 to a 55, and the English 1, 21 to a 30, and the 13 to a 20 in English 2, which is our area of focus for English 2, as it has been. We can hone down on special education students approaching SCORE in ELA from an 18 to a 22, math 48 to a 52, as well as the ELLs. We have work to do there from 47 to 55 and math from 62 to 70, which we'll continue with our distinctions if we're able to meet that point. Increase academic growth score from 85 to 90 by monitoring and tracking student growth from eighth grade math to algebra 1 and English 1 to English 2. So those are the strong points for Sheridan High School. Any questions? No?
Okay. Thank you, Ms. Garza.
I'm off to an eighth grade volleyball game. My daughter's last name.
Good luck to you.
Good luck.
Well,
she does.
Good luck.
Okay.
Good evening.
Okay, good evening, Dr. Vidal and members of the board. I am here representing, of course, Benson Elementary, so our campus initiatives. We are providing teachers continued support and guidance through structured planning and preparation days designed to provoke conversations around state standards and teaching and learning experiences. And this is using our instructional calendar, looking at our lead forward accountability reports and making sure that we are digging a little deeper as far as those conversations having to do with instruction and how we're teaching it in the classroom, getting into those why is this teacher scoring higher than this teacher, and then comparing and trying to work together as a team. Foster a goal-driven culture and set STAR 2020 goals with students through the implementation of individual student growth trackers. Teachers, students, and administrators will monitor growth after each DPA. So each student has their growth tracking sheets, and they are setting goals before each DPA and coming back and reflecting over the DPAs afterwards as to whether or not they have met, and if they have not met their goals, is having those conversations and conferences with their teachers afterwards. And of course, continuing to implement Capturing Kids' Hearts to foster positive relationships between teachers and students. And our goal is to be recognized as a Capturing Kids' Hearts Showcase campus, and that is official now. Benson has been nominated. Last week, we received the nomination to become one of the campuses that is going to be visited to be recognized as a showcase campus. So we're going to start the process. One of the things we're really trying to monitor. Areas of focus, we're going to monitor student subpopulations and target scores. This is where we fell a little bit under the margin of the quartile one. We were part of the quartile three. So we are wanting to make sure that we are at the top so that we can earn that distinction of the academic growth. For that, we need to be able to score at least an 80. Our comparison group, that was the bottom, so we're hoping for an 82, which is the next bullet that we're aiming for. If we increase our closing the gap domain three score from a 71 to a 76, that will definitely ensure us to maintain that A rating, because that'll take us to an 82. So an 82 will give us a margin of error in case of course, all consideration being that our 40 schools remain at the same level. And increased parental involvement, we are implementing on-site nutrition classes as well as ESL classes. Those are going to kick off this next week. And our nutrition classes started 2 weeks ago. We're trying to bring the community in and involve them at our campus. So we started with five, and I was happy to see five. This last Wednesday, they each brought somebody else in addition to themselves. So we're slowly growing them, and our ESL classes will start. We're having orientation this Thursday and kick off the following week twice a week. So. Any questions? No? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Flores.
Good evening, Dr. Vidaudi and the board. Our campus initiatives for Ogarza are as follow. We're implementing the after-school accelerated instruction child care program that provides free and after-school care for all students. We're up to the 115 students already from pre-K through 6. So we use a lot of that time for the actual instructional part. So we actually targeted a lot of the kids that we do need for the growth of master. Increase attendance for both staff and students by monitoring on a monthly basis and providing corresponding recognitions. The attendance is an area that we're also working really hard, and it's also with the staff. Instead of waiting for the 6 weeks, we're doing it by the month. With our 40 comparison group, we were, even though we had a 96, we were number two with our 40 comparison group, so they were a lot lower, but we still want to work at 98, only because that just means that the kids are there, and we need them. We need them there. And then continuing with the Capturing Kids' Heart, in order to strengthen students' connectedness to others by enhancing healthy bonds with their teachers and establishing collaborative agreements of acceptable behavior. And that's worked really well for us, especially with the behavior when they become an issue in the classroom. It's very minimal that we've had to deal with actual behavior issues where it impedes the learning. So we are working, we've worked really hard at that, and we've got that in check. So the areas of focus: increase academic growth component score from a 68 to an 82 to receive an A rating for the 2019-2020 school year. Again, it's just monitoring the growth, the students that hit the master level, making sure that we have that intense instruction. At Ogarza, historically, we've brought a lot of those kids to the grade level, but now it's sustaining. So now that's where the issue is, because even if they fall just one band, well, one area of percentage below, we've already gotten hit with gold. But the teachers have really worked really hard at getting them to that level. So now it's just sort of tightening that and making sure that they're decrease, or they don't regress, not even a little bit. And then increase our closing the gap domain scale score from a 75 to 95 to ensure the A rating. Again, it's our sub-pops that we've got to target, and especially in the next bullet, which is our special ed, which is a group of students also that we have 34, so we do have a high number of special ed kids, but we've already identified them, and these were struggling kids that had not been identified yet. So once you hit the 25, that's when you start getting measured. So we are at 34 right now, and now we're just getting the percentage, the 19% of those 34, the 23, to ensure that we get the needs and the academic for them, and of course all of the kids, but at least to hit that target. So increase the student achievement within the special education sub-pop. reading from 7 to 19%, and that comes out to, it's four kids that we need to find and make sure that they meet that 90% out of the 34. And math from 14 to 23, we're looking at about 12 kids, also that we need to ensure that they reach the growth and the meets and increase overall student achievement within the special ed population from 17 to the 23% to hit the federal targets. Any questions?
Good evening, everyone. So at Inahosa, what we're doing is for the first campus initiative, what we're trying to do is tap into those master teachers. So what we're working currently, and tomorrow's a perfect example, we're trying to find that vertical and horizontal alignment, especially with the new math and the reading adoption. So tomorrow, our first grade teachers are going to do some rounds into kinder to see how they have their group set up. So then we're going to spend that time collecting the data, and then the following day, we're going to put our captain of our kindergarten team with our first grade team to make sure that we have alignment with first grade, because we're seeing some changes from kinder to first grade. So we're going to be focusing on that. And that's an example of how we're tackling that initiative. The second initiative is guiding the students in third through sixth grade with their tracker. So one of the things that we're doing, myself and our assistant principal, we're actually going into the classroom to making sure the trackers are there and having those conversations with students. So I've already been in sixth grade, and it's amazing how when you sit with students and you have that conversation about their range and what they're working for, they light up, they understand it now, you know, and it's, we're being more transparent with students now, so they really understand that, you know, you really only need a 53 in some subjects to be approaching. So kids are realizing, I don't want to be at a 53, I want to push myself through that higher range. So that's one of the things that we're doing with that. And then intentionally increasing the number of opportunities for students to write and speak in the class period through journals and extra exit tickets. So through walkthroughs and feedback with the teachers and what they're submitting, we're really going into the rooms to see what they're doing in writing. You can go in and do a walkthrough, and sometimes you don't capture it because you're not looking for it. So this year we're spending a lot more time really going into the rooms to find it, to look for it and dig for it, because a lot of times we miss that. So our goal is to be focused on our goal, which is monitoring the writing and the speaking. So as we go in, we document on a walkthrough, and we're having that correspondence back and forth with them on the walkthroughs. So that's one of our initiatives as well. And then the area of focus, the first area of focus and the second one is both in Talpas. So one of the things that we're working with the teachers is that vertical alignment as well, because when first grade teachers and second grade teachers do their ratings, sometimes they rate the students too high. So then when they get to the upper grade, it's very hard. So they're not really ready. So we have to really be monitoring how teachers are rating and what input they're giving as well. So we're going to be looking at our whole system vertically to make sure that by the time the students get to fifth and sixth grade, when they're sitting at advanced high, we're really able to move that needle like Jake says and get them to that advanced high. And then the middle one is provide opportunities for parents to review the student trackers. So every meeting that we have with a parent, being an ARD meeting, RTI 504, we have those trackers so parents can see what's going on as well. Questions?
Is that the 2 minute rule? Yeah. They really are timing.
We changed it to three.
We changed it to three, but it's definitely
not. Yeah. He didn't tell anyone.
Next. I know. I thought next. You were joking.
I made it 2 years. Like it's now three.
I'm taking tabs of who's beeping. I get the beep.
Who's next?
Dr.
Allison. You get a text.
Dr. Allison. Is that a
very good.
That's my kid.
Good evening, Dr. Dowdy, board president and members of the board. As you can see, I have here my initiatives are implement after-school accelerated instruction child care program that provides free after-school care for all students. But y'all are all aware of that we're running the program. It's running phenomenally right now. If you were to go and watch, that's because we haven't bought our curriculum kits, because what we're doing is we're looking at all the vendors, see what they can offer us, because I'm trying to go for the best deal I can get. But we're trying to do all hands-on activities. So we're doing things like STEM scope. We're buying FOSS kits. Like FOSS kits is correlated with leveled readers that are all science-based. And so we're trying to get in there where the kids are doing manipulatives and being able to do higher order type of rigor curriculum. So we're trying to correlate, trying to get them to that level, because in the classroom we're trying to teach what we need to do every day. Second one is provide a 2-day training with Deb Diller, Balanced Literacy Reading Program. It's a professional development in order to support financial reading skills and reduce the achievement gap for all students' subpopulations. When I was at Hinojosa, I brought her in, and that's how I started Hinojosa with this young lady, and she's phenomenal. She's now at the national level where she is being booked. It's very hard to get her, and she personally is coming to us because I'm calling her again, and I had gotten her from Katie. So like I said, she's gonna help us to put working stations into the classroom. And I'm so excited that all teachers are running with it. Because normally your upper level, fifth and sixth, are like, why do we need to do centers? Not with them, they're like, no, we wanna do it too. So I'm so excited for that. Continue to implement capturing kids' hearts to foster positive relationships between teachers and students. We are using compliment strips on proper etiquette and school-wide manners. Wow. What a difference has this little paper does. Anytime a kid gets caught saying, yes ma'am, no ma'am, good morning Dr. Arte, and I make them say the person's name. Like Mr. Garcia, you were one of, when we came, right away they called him good morning, you know, Mr. Garcia. Or when we had the judge here, good morning Judge Maldonado. They're learning proper etiquette. And so every time they do something like that, we give them a confidence strip. And so at the end of the reporting period, I have the lower levels competing against the upper level. And the ones with the most compliment strip gets a pizza party. So these run rapid. They see you walking, that's it. They're all reading their books or they're doing their homework. What a change. Yeah, it's made a change. So area focus, of course, increased attendance from 97.1 to 98. Also through effective implementation of the bilingual program model, student progress will increase on the TELPA's progress rate from 33 to 40%. We've been doing some things with the bilingual program. I've kind of created some frameworks. We're doing time and treatment with the kids, and we're doing it by grade level, making sure that the kids are moving along and closing that gap. So that way we can do well on that. And then of course, achieve the STAR ELAR distinctions by increasing mastery level in third grade to 23 to 25, fourth to 17 through 20%, fifth grade 23 to 25%, and sixth grade 19 to 21%, and fourth grade writing 7% to 10th. And then, of course, increase the growth points earned from 65 to 85, so we can get that A rating.
Awesome.
Any questions? Try my best.
And I did get to visit with the after-school program, and, you know, you always think about it's daycare service, and they're just taking care of kids. No. Mm-hmm. Kids were engaged, and they were like, okay, can you leave now? Because I got to go on to my next little thing to do, and it was just amazing.
It was hands-on.
Hats off.
Yeah.
Hats off.
I did have just a quick relation, certainly, basically. I think you were at the last meeting we discussed, Jensen. We want all our campuses to do well. That's without question, but we understand that maybe Jensen may need a little more help. Mm-hmm. Hence why I think we just discussed the after school thing. But in terms of, I guess I don't want to see us to have all the testing done, get the results sometime next year and say, oh, you should have done something different. And so the measurability as to whether we need to be doing something different between now and May, whether we need to be tweaking what we're doing, when's that taking place and how often is that taking place?
It's taking place every 4 to 6 weeks. We give what we call data point assessments or DPAs, and it's actually whatever we've taught for the last 6 weeks. We test all the children K through EOC, and then we sit down. We've actually gone through one round of DPAs. Every single principal came in. We sat down. We treated their DPA scores as if they were STAR, and they walked out with a letter grade. And we're going to do that every single time. So there's no surprises.
And as a principal, I turned it around to my staff, and I trained them how to do it. I said, from now on, you're going to come with the information. And then they got to see, you're at a C right now. You're at this right now. And they were like, I'm a D person, teacher. I'm an A. They were like, oh, no, this is not happening. So now that they see it on paper, that we're ranking them just like the state, oh, different game plan with them now. Totally different. But we're going to do that every reporting period.
Also, Dr. Gorena is
piggybacking off that as well, there is a plan that had to be written here. She is meeting with Dr. Osted. They are talking about, so you've got regular ed curriculum happening, and then you've got special pops, and the whole entire plan as to what they're doing because of the deal that they got in those two.
Yeah, I think we talked a lot about Jensen L. Garland, which is part of that discussion as well.
Yes.
And again, this, you're just acknowledging that they may need that community, those community areas may just need just a little bit more help. And, you know, and I keep telling everybody, I love all my children, but I recognize they're all different and some need more help than others. But I want them all to succeed.
But when we were talking about this, didn't we bring up some specific stuff?
I don't have time to go by memory, but I think just acknowledging that.
Or finding.
That we tell us what you need, and we will enact out some number, which is it's just a number. But the spirit of throwing out a number was, let us know what you need. Because what we do know is that if you do well, regardless as well, and everybody continues to do well, oh my God,
the best. So working specifically with Garza and Jensen, in fact, just this last week, and already a timeline through next week and throughout until the end of the year, very specifically through a framework that Dr. Vidaldi just mentioned, to make sure that foundationally, all those key levers, there's five, and this is you know, state-supported, research-based, that we are assuring to identify those and then having really specific plans toward those. So school leadership planning, curriculum, et cetera.
It's called the objective. Y'all were talking about it like a program, like if there was a program
or just
out there.
Finding something.
And we come
something
back.
Different, because, and I think maybe part of that decision was, we kind of know what the result is of what we're currently doing, and I think that was maybe part of that.
Right, and the deal is that it's not a program that's going to get you to the A. It's what we're doing every day, and how we're monitoring the instructional leadership component of that, how we're monitoring the students and what we're teaching, having them making sure that they're following the curriculum that we have, because what they did last year got us to a point. If we change that, then how are we going to know where we're going to get next time? We already know where we're at here.
Yeah,
so point. Now we tweak that, and we move from there. And our deal is to make sure that we're not completely turning over and doing something different. And that's what I'm going to compliment the leadership team, Pam and Jake, Jennifer, if she's here, and Dr. Gordena. We've got to stay, because that's what got us to where we were at, 78. I mean, we say C, but it was right there. So we want that and then tweaking that. So that's the area that we're working on. Of course, the added money and the finance stuff is the extra stuff that she's doing, the little monitoring, the after-school program. Those kinds of things are going to help that with the motivation, and we want to make sure we're addressing with GARS as well on that. So that's kind of where we're at. It has to be very intentional and very focused, and we can't deviate too much, because then it'll throw.
And part of the thing that I'm doing is on the effective school framework, which God put me here because I went to a two-day training last year. Yeah. Just because it was the latest thing, I knew it was something that was being important in the state of Texas, and now I have to do the plan. So it's perfect. I totally understand it. Dr. Gordena did not have to train me, because it was like, okay, I know what you're talking about, yes, and we're going to do it. And so we met last week, and so we've got a timeline that we're going to put together and be able to, but it's things that's research-based.
Yeah.
It's really not difficult.
I was going to touch on another subject, but just going back on what Ricky said, is this something we should have started back in September? Or are we going to find any other programs that we should have started or we can start later on?
Areas will be identified as you tighten up, but I'll tell you that the levers by which that are named in this framework are the key essential pieces in any school. You know, effective instruction, effective leadership, planning, school climate, you know, those kinds of things. So however we can support them once we continue to identify, because these ladies, in it's obvious just through our conversations that we had last week, for example, a couple of days, and even before then, obvious that foundationally they have put many, many things in place. This will take it, there's some very key practices that are named there that we go in and look for. We've got to look for evidence. I mean, it's a very, it's an on-site, hands-on structure that we work through. and that we'll continue to find. Will we find a couple of things? Possibly.
And remove barriers.
Yeah. We'll continue to work through those.
And that's fine. That's fine. That's part of the journey.
Mm-hmm.
I would hate for it, speaking of my view, to get to the end and said, why didn't you do that? Well, because we didn't think y'all would even approve it.
Right.
You didn't give us opportunities
and
to
that,
say.
That was part of the conversation.
You say no. I mean, come on. Or say yes, or whatever it is.
We want every single principal to know that we will do everything we can to get to where we want to be. We want to get there as badly as
possible. Yeah, we want to be part of the celebration. And, did it. And
we most certainly know that there is nothing when it comes to curriculum and instruction and things that we need in the classroom. There's not a no from Mr. Gonzalez or from Mr. Ortega when it comes to that. Because all the other campuses also have some particular things that they might need. And we know that from y'all, and we totally appreciate that, 100%. We know that if it's for instruction and for kids, that you guys never say no to us. So we appreciate that. But we're focused and we're intentional. It's been a quick start, and it's been a very focused and intentional, and we're all working together as a team. These meetings that they had with the principals, and y'all are here, you can disagree with me if you want, but those have been so intentional and have helped us identify things together as a team. And I've been just so, so proud of campus leadership and of central office leadership. I sat in on those meetings and we're really dissecting everything. I mean, they want it, we all want it really, really bad this year. So it's been good. We're all tired and we're still October, but it's a lot of work to be that intentional. And none of us have all the answers, but together we're coming up with those, identifying those areas. They come in, for example, they come in and sit down and think it's one thing, and Jake sits there looking at it and nope, can't be that. Mathematically, can't be that. Well, yes, it is. It's this. But imagine that when that principal leaves there knowing, I thought it was this problem, and now I know it wasn't that problem. Because all of us are sitting in there looking at data from a different perspective. So that principal then walks away, and it was your instance where you thought, nope, it's this. Jake's sitting there saying, mathematically, it can't be that. So now she went back, a better principal, because now she identified exactly what was happening with that certain percentage. So that's the, I'm just giving that as an example. That's how intentional it has been with every single campus. Down to this kid, this 5 kids, this 10 kids, this group, this scenario.
These discussions.
Super proud of everybody.
Heard, yeah, I noticed that with Betty when she was like, okay, we know which 4 kids. And
Betty
like,
will tell you where they live,
what
he's doing. Everything.
Well, that's how you go from good to great. That's
the snippets of professional development for the principals' meetings that we're, just putting things leadership-wise on the table for them to take back and tools, that they can come back and use. Refine their practices, and so also embedding those pieces in there.
And taking it back, having the collaboration with your teachers, because every SPDM, they have to approve the staff development.
Yeah,
they can't just come from you all.
Exactly what I was about to say, that I'm glad you're going down in the trenches, each principal, all of them.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's the direction from staff is to go down and get to know the 500 plus students that you have, especially in the elementary level, because once you let them go to the junior high, it's a little bit tougher because you have 5 or 6 classes that you have to meet. But in this case, that you're going down in the trenches and given that opportunity for the teachers to also be leaders and give that same task that they give you from upstate to follow. Thank you.
But we do thank you. Thank you,
thank you
the board,
you for
supporting everything.
Next.
Good evening, Dr. Vidali and members of the board. On behalf of John H. Scherer, I'm here to share our campus initiatives. And we start off with providing intentional instructional support through guided planning and prep opportunities and ongoing data analysis. So we all know how important data analysis is and having a plan. And I, for one, have to say thank you to all of our CNI team because I think that the level and not just the intensity, but the intentionality of the planning that we're doing this year, it has definitely been taken to a new level. We do it at the campus level. We've brought in consultants to kind of help us track students and understand the measures and the game by which we're all rated and judged by. And so at the campus level, we've been doing a lot of that. But now, with the support of CNI, we're definitely able to add that next layer. And for us, it was specifically that growth component. And so you'll hear me talking about that a little bit later. But having time that's guided and that's intentional is very, very important for our campuses. And I'm sure all the others as well, right? But I can definitely see a difference at my campus. My next one is cultivate a shared vision and culture of educational excellence by setting high expectations and encouraging a positive campus climate. And so at my particular campus, I can say that we are a go, go, go campus. I mean, you hit that campus and you don't sit down until, very late in the evening. And I know that my teachers are in it for their students, and they're there for the right reasons, but they get a little tired and they get a little burned out. And so we do push and push and push. And so I think this year it's just really also being able to reflect on them and making sure that they're okay, that they're in a good place so that they can be the best for the kids. And so really cultivating not just that high expectations steps that we push through having our data talks, but also making sure that as a campus, our teachers are happy and they want to be there and they want to serve the kids that are at our school. Along those same lines, we go to the implementing Capturing Kids' Hearts. And so I'll say that that was a training that we had this year, at the beginning of the school year. And although it took away some training days for us, it was very much needed. I think that in the world that we live in, again, go, 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 it's important for us to sit back and to reflect on, are we building those relationships? Because we know that kids will work for you when they know how much you care. And when they know that you're doing everything to help them be successful. And so Capturing Kids' Hearts has definitely done that for us. Our areas of focus, again, based on those intensive data talks that we've had, are to increase our student academic growth domain from a 73 to a 77. That is the one distinction that we missed this year, and so that's the one that we're wanting to hit. Also, we're working on monitoring our bilingual program implementation to increase our THELPAS progress rate from 42 to 45. And so at Joan and Sherry, our demographics have changed quite a bit, and so our teachers are having to kind of make sure that we are doing the right thing for our EL students. Increase attendance. We know that attendance is always very important. This past year, we were able to hit that mark, and that really helped us out with our distinctions. So we're wanting to take it from a 96.9 to a 98. And then finally, monitor individual student growth in math specifically, as per our meetings with the CNI team, to increase our student growth score from a 72 to a 75. And so not just maintaining, but trying to push that growth measure just a little bit more with intentionality and focus.
And Ms. Gerlach, we were fortunate enough, Dr. V and I, last year to sit in or to be there on your campus when you were having your little sessions mm-hmm. in the hall with the kids, and your scores were dramatically improved. Can you explain a little bit how you use that to encourage and?
Sure. So we used a growth tracker for our students, and so when they came in, depending on the subject area, it's by subject, they were able to mark on their chart what color they fell in. And so we use the color band system. And so it goes all the way from red all the way to a dark blue. And so the kids were able to come in and track what color they were. And so our message to them was, it's all about leveling up. It's all about growth. And so it wasn't really a number that we had on there. It wasn't a line that they had to meet. But their goal was to move from one color to the next color, and from that color to the next color. And so similar to what the district put in place this year for their for our district growth trackers, that was a system. And so we made time, and I say made time because you have to carve out time for this kind of stuff. It takes time, but I really do believe that it motivated our students to, and it helped them understand, this is where I'm at and this is where I want to be. So we set goals for all of them, and slowly they continued to track in reading or in math, and they met their goals. So it was very successful.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Gerlach.
Next.
Good evening, board.
The first thing I want to do is I want to thank you, because giving us that planning and preparation day has been a big help to the teacher. It lets them be deliberate and focus on the planning for the new 6 weeks. A lot of times you guys don't think, when the teachers go home, they have a lot of stuff to do at home with their families, and they don't have the time to do the planning they need to do. By giving them this day that you gave them, the planning prep day, they're able to be deliberate, and then I really believe all the scores are going to reflect that when you see how it looks. The next thing I have up there is the growth trackers. Everybody spoke about it. It's about the students tracking their growth and stuff like that, but what good is that? What good is it is they're knowing what they need to track and what they need to work on, but it also lets us know as principals to go and work on these things and help them. I know when I sat down with Pam and Jake over the growth meeting, the biggest thing that we found on that was the kids can now see if they're regressing or progressing. And like we tell the kids, we only want to get better. The next thing, we provide teachers mini sessions on student and teacher welfare to help them excel in the classroom. I brought in Dr. Guerra from the university. He came in and he spoke about ADHD with the teachers and gave the teacher strategies on what to do with kids that have ADHD to help them out. I also brought in the PhD candidate, Dr. Botero, who's doing mindfulness training with the teachers. My big thing is, how am I helping the people that take care of my kids? What am I doing? What strategies am I giving them to succeed? So one of those things is we're trying to find ways to help them so they have good, strong mental health. And if they don't have good, strong mental health, how to seek or how to have strategies provided to them so they can get better. And I want to take care of the teachers big time on that. My areas of focus, it's probably one that we've seen up here, the academic growth. I want to go from 77 to 82 to maintain my A rating. The next two, at Shimatsu, we just don't want to pass. We want to be the best of the best. And the next two goals there is for third grade math and sixth grade reading, we want to increase our master's scores. Because if we increase our master's scores, we're going to end up getting the academic growth rating that we're shooting for. And the last thing we want to monitor our younger students, our first through third graders, on their reading fluency. Because if they're reading and they're reading well, it's going to help them in every other subject that we have at school. So, any questions? I'm kind of quick.
Thank you.
Thank you.
At Wernicke Elementary, we are looking to continue providing our teachers with that ongoing guidance and support during our planning and prep days. We already had our first one, and it was amazing, as you've heard, so we do appreciate that in our calendar. Safety and security is on all of our hearts, so with the big campus, even more so, we're really vigilant, and we want to implement the Watchdogs program. It's a nationwide program, and it stands for Dads of Great Students. So looking to involve more of our dads in volunteering and in being in our, in our car pickup line, our picnics, things like that. So we're excited about that. And also just increasing our student behavior, the positive student behavior in the Capturing Kids Hearts program. And we've already started the implementation and it's going really well. So our areas of focus. We want to increase the percentage of our English learners who meet the TELPRESS progress rate. So we want to go from our 42, which we did very well, but we want to get that 45. We want a solid A. We were an A, but we want that A plus. So that is also our growth component score, from a 74 to a 77. Again, that solid A plus. Our attendance rating, we're doing really well. We're making gains, 97.3, but we want to get that 98. Almost there. We want our distinction in our ELAR, so we need to increase our master's level in our third grade from 30 to 32. Fourth grade, we're looking at 31 to 33, and then our writing 11 to 17%. We've got to increase that. We also want our distinction in STAR science, so increasing our master's level 23 to 30%. So working very hard and being very targeted and tutoring the top, getting that master's level. Questions?
I have one.
Yes,
because I keep seeing the attendance, and it's like
a tenth of a percentage.
Like, equate that to absences. Like, I'm thinking, oh, yeah, you can go 0.7%. No problem, you know. But you're saying it's hard.
Yeah, I think it's like what Lori had talked about, the last 10 pounds. It's for me, it was changing the culture of the campus. You know, if one child is absent, don't keep the whole family at home. You know, getting them.
But equate that to like.
Number of kids.
Like, how many kids can you afford?
I have 623 kids, or 12 kids. 12 kids are out daily.
Which is nothing. It sounds, and to me, it sounds like nothing when you're talking about
60 to 80.
I'd almost be grateful. Oh, good. I'm a good Johnny Jackson. I'm kidding. No, that kid's never absent, right?
Yeah. No, that's good, man.
Man, David, you gave her 5 minutes, brother. David,
she got 5 minutes.
If you wouldn't have given her 5 minutes, I was going to get really mad at you, man.
Well, I started thinking about like the way people are down here on cold weather.
Yes.
You know,
rain.
I was just trying to figure out how many kids is like kills you.
I can give you a percentage. Like on October the 18th, she has 763 kids on her campus. She had 27 absent, and she's at a 96.46 for that day.
Okay. Well, see, now I understand it.
And then Friday's a cutoff day for that, right?
For
Snapchat.
Yes.
So you gotta make sure you're all there.
So it, for us, like if it's raining, I extend my tardy time a little bit. We have fun activities before a holiday so that, some of y'all have been my parents.
Yeah, yeah.
Snapchat's a big deal. So, just different things we put in place before the holiday when we know kids are gonna be out. So to try and get them to.
Yeah. I'm not that
I just wanted a little number.
Thank you.
I just happened to have it on my screen.
That was so cute.
You got 2 minutes.
Okay. Good evening, Dr. Vidali, members of the board. The campus initiatives for Beale Grade Junior High are to continue to meet the Texas School to Watch national endorsement criteria for high-performing middle schools, which consist of academic excellence, developmental responsiveness, social equity, and organizational structures for continuous improvement. That's a lot in one.
You can do it.
But it's basically a rubric, which was a self-study, that we ourselves just rated how we were doing in those domains. And of course, we did great in academic excellence and even in organizational structures, but we're continuing to improve on the developmental responsiveness and social equity, which is more like the social-emotional part of our students. Second one is support instructional decision-making with relevant data systems, such as the Forward and the Texas Color Bands. And to impact student behavior and enhance school climate by implementing capturing kids' hearts processes of building relational capacity and conflict management skills. Our areas of focus is to increase our special education student growth status in reading from 61 to 70.4 in domain 3, which is closing the gaps. The target is 59, but still that was like too close to comfort for us, okay? And then to increase the TELPIS progress rate from 40% to 50% under the English language proficiency status in domain 3, which is closing the gaps. 77 of our current EL students will increase one or more proficiency levels or maintain an advanced high in their composite rating. Before the waiver, the target was 42%. With the waiver, it's 36. We were at 40, but we still want to do better than that. And then increase the overall average of approaches, meets, and masters for social studies on STAR performance in domain 1 from an 86% to a 90%. Any questions?
How does the capturing kids' hearts work at junior high? I mean, what are the results? Are they this?
Well, actually, it's funny that you asked, because this year is the first year Beale Grade launches capturing kids' hearts, and you're kind of like a little hesitant because it's secondary, like how is that going to go over? But
Man, it was really a great bonding, not for our faculty, first of all, just building relationships with our staff and faculty. It was a great way to start off the year. And then it's been great watching the teachers just implement the strategies with the kids. And we've always been real good with building relationships with our scholars, but just being more intentional about it, you know, not becoming complacent. And so we started off with the social contracts, with just building in the time in that first couple of weeks of school to build relationships. They start their day with the good things, right? Something to share that's going on with them, to make that connection with them. And today, actually, we had John H. Sherry at our campus, and what they did was we each gave like 10 names of teachers who wanted to be part of the leadership team of being process champions to keep like capturing kids' hearts at the forefront, so that, because with so much going on, you don't want it to, like, you know, you get started real strong and then you just let life get in the way. Mm-hmm. But a team of teachers is going to lead capturing kids' hearts and keep it at the forefront for us.
In terms of decrease of referrals, but do you see that kind of correlation, whether it's at that campus or the other campus?
Because you hold kids accountable, I guess.
Usually, that's what we want to measure.
Kids are held accountable for their actions.
The decrease of referrals, so that would be a good way to measure it, but we're just launching this year.
Well, it's going to help you with the social equity that you mentioned earlier.
But those that have used it in the past.
It just started, and I can see already a decrease.
You're changing the culture.
So, following up on a question that Rick has, like for instance, Bill Gray, her goal is 70, right? And she wants to go from 61 to 70. So, on a monthly basis in your meetings that you're having, or every 6 weeks, how are we going to measure that until we take the exam?
Well, with every mini exam we're taking, we go back to that original target, and they spend an hour with us with tier one instruction, and then they spend the second hour with Dr. Gordon and Jennifer looking at just each subpop. So not only do you look at your data, and that's an added piece that we added this year, is going through and say, okay, we missed the bar on some of our sub populations, so this year we removed that barrier to where now you spend an hour on tier one, and then an hour over here going, okay, you need to hit this target, and so where are you? If this were the star, would you have met the target, yes or no? And they have them write it out on a big chart and go through yes or no for each.
But these
target.
Are teachers doing that, right?
No, these are principals.
No,
principals. Oh, the principals turn it around with their campuses.
Yes.
And
okay,
season.
So the campuses, okay, the principals go back to the campus and they say, okay, teachers.
Yes.
We have
take them through
the same data conversation.
Yeah, the same conversation.
So September already went by. Mm-hmm. We're almost done with October. So do we know more or less where we're at? 61, 62 points?
Yes, I can. We could go back and look at her. I don't have exactly.
No.
Yeah, as a whole, yes, sir. Mm-hmm.
Yes, and I actually
away
that
knowing
same target. I did miss the special ed and ELs. It continues to be the same subpops that we all struggle with.
But
we are being intentional as far as like, okay, what are we doing different? We go back with them. So like one of the things that we're doing is the class kick, and so we're having the students practice more of what they're being assessed with the speaking and the writing, and providing them opportunities to have conversations, to record themselves, because that's all going to be required when they take the TELPUS, when they take the online supports that are on STAR. So it's not just knowing the data, but then what do you go back and do with it differently?
So I think initially maybe one piece to help you better understand, so taking them through the exact methodology, taking the DPA through exactly all these pieces that you're seeing about closing the gap, and 61 to 70 and all these different pieces, that's what's given them the pulse of where they're at in terms of, so it's.
And one thing I like is kind of like Shimotsu came up and then he says, well, we're looking to increase our masters. So he's already done with the approaches and needs. So he's got that out of the way. So he's looking at focusing on masters. In other words, he's already good, he wants to get better, right? And that's our goal in Shareland, is basically just the tradition of excellence. So we just basically got to get better, right? But that's the goal.
Our new accountability is not just
but
masters.
You have to hit every single child.
The differences that you're seeing and what they're mentioning, like you heard him with masters and then you hear others with growth, the data is driving where that next mark is for that campus. So they're not all the
yes, but like him, that he has a mark. His mark is
masters.
Masters. Why? Because he's done with everything else?
That was one of his, so they, some schools will be focused on masters to either earn a distinction or keep their distinctions. That's one piece of accountability. And other schools, and Mr. Limon is focusing on growth because that kept him from one of his distinctions. So he has to focus on growth, not just a master's, but growth every single child.
No, of course. That's just one of the focus points that I saw. Correct. But I noticed that he specifically is focusing on
that masters. Was for a distinction. And remember, our campuses chase, our secondaries chase 7 distinctions.
Sure.
So, yeah, they're constantly, and they're getting it from every different direction. Accountability is very...
No, and I know...
It's every child matters. Every single, and you...
You
got
to compare to 40
schools.
I know you voted for President Bush.
Right.
No. But anyway, I'm just kidding about that. But
I am so Democratic.
I'm just kidding.
And the reason I chose social studies is because in our content areas, that's the lowest, and even that percent is high for the state of Texas.
The lowest and the hardest. It's
the lowest and the hardest. And yeah, and that's pretty high for the state, but we want the
Ms. Pamela, I know that we have different focuses for different campuses and everybody's mm-hmm. basically focus on their campus training. But I would imagine the administration is looking at everything
yes.
and looking at all the different focuses that you have in the different campuses, and you're also kind of mingling here and there with some of the other focuses that other principals have, right?
Yes, of course. Mm-hmm. Yes. Once you identify the data, the next piece is going in. What are you, if you identify a problem and you do nothing about it, and say, here's your data, but it goes back to, it's very key to what the principals are doing. I commend them because they go back, present the data, and they say, okay, what are we going to do to move from here to here? Because if we do the same thing, we're going to get the same result. So they're moving
action plans for sure.
Yeah. And they're doing a phenomenal job. Well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes. Next is going to be North. Actually, I'm going to be presenting for Mrs. Hassan because she is actually at the university in one of her doctoral classes. So I told her if she would let me, I would fill in for her instead.
We're going to ask you all the questions.
Yeah, it's okay. I'm ready. I study. Okay, the campus initiatives for North Junior High are implement SIOP best practices through targeted professional development, focus walkthroughs, and feedback with an emphasis on speaking and writing. And once again, this is to ensure that they meet their professional progress measures, making sure, well, you've heard that a lot through our principals, but what kind of speaking and writing are going on in our classrooms, because that's hurting us instead of us. And it just makes a better student, because how many of you have to speak and write in your daily, no matter what profession you have, be able to speak intelligently and write and make sure it's understandable. Also, the students and staff are monitoring their performance after each GPA and benchmark utilizing the student growth tracker. And then they are a capturing kids' hearts that they're just implementing this year. They're one of the 4 campuses that just received that. And Laureen is very wanting to make sure everyone know that if you have a child's heart, you have a child's mind. So that's their philosophy, and that's what they're focusing on there at North, is those strong relationships and making sure that we have their heart so we can have their mind. Makes a big difference with students. Their areas of focus, when we drill down into their data, they want to increase the percentage of students meeting, achieving meets grade level standard or above in ELAR academic achievement from a 58 to a 65%. Increase the Thad Plus progress rate from 29 to 42 under the EL proficiency status in closing the gaps domain 3. So that means 72 students need to advance on the Thad Plus progress measure by 1 or more proficiency level. So she's broken it down to how many kids by 1 or more level. So they are very focused and very intentional where they did not meet those targets. And then that was a target from STAR last year, and now every time we meet data, they're actually going down to the number of kids and what do I need to do to move the needle. Increase the percentage of special education students achieving meets grade level, standard above in reading from 39 to 45%. And when on these, Mr. Sadler, whenever you hear the word meets, they're saying meets because it's not approaches, but it's not masters, but meets is what they have to the achievement level they need to meet for the closing the gap. So when we look at our subpopulation, we're really focusing on those children needing at least needs for masters. So that's why you're hearing the meets here.
State.
And then increase the percentage of EL students achieving meets grade level standard or above in reading from 19 to 25. And here comes her masters. Increase master's level performance in all tested area, reading 30 to 30, 31 to 37, math 46 to 50, science 41 to 45, and social studies 23 to 30%.
So she has a lot more work to do than Bill Gray, and it's the same amount of work. Basically, she's got a lot of more focus points to.
Yes, so like every campus looks at their different targets, and then Bill Gray had perfect distinctions. This campus did not have perfect distinctions, so that's why they're trying to get those master's level to get those distinctions.
So on the TELPAS, so Bill Gray has, she wants to go from a 40 to a 50.
Yes.
And the TELPAS for North is...
They did not meet the target.
They didn't even get to
no, they did the not target. Meet the target.
So we're trying to push them to get to
that's
the target.
That's why her number one campus initiative was working on the SIOP model, going through. She's already connected with Mrs. Gonzalez and Mrs. Gomera over in the bilingual department federal programs, going, okay, this is an initiative that I really need to make sure that we're focusing on our independent learners.
Good evening, everybody. Okay, so ours are pretty simple. Of course, we're doing, you know, the same things everybody else is doing with the DPAs and the growth trackers. We're doing all that. But these are some things that we're doing a little different. To begin with, about 2 years ago, we read a book called Fundamental Five. So one of the things we took out of that was a product task. And what a product task is when teachers write their objectives on the board, the next thing they write on there is how students are gonna demonstrate what they've learned that day. And so whether it's a quick exit ticket or a partner share, pair share, so the teachers kind of get every day they get a glimpse of what the students learned that day and at to what level. So that's what we're focused on. That's one of the things that we're doing. And of course this year, we really, since one of our sub pops that really hurts is a special ed, we felt like our teachers' plans, they're getting a little lazy writing their lesson plans when it comes to differentiation, which is how you know what you're doing different to help your special ed students and your ELs and your 504 students and even GT. And so we're focused this year on how they write their differentiation in their lesson plans. And so as administrators, we're really looking at those lesson plans and we're giving feedback to teachers about what we see and what we want to see. They've been trained on how to write them by our special ed department. So they know what to look for and what to write. And then, you know, of course, teachers in high school, they've been teaching for 20 years in a high school classroom. It's difficult to get them to change anything, you know. But you keep that pressure on them. You keep, you know, showing them what it is that they're doing wrong and how you can correct it. And again, with the DPA and the, you know, seeing how the students are scoring, that's also another way that they learn that they're not doing, they need to change what they're doing. And so planning is one of the ways that we're changing that. CCMR is a big thing at the high school level. And so one of the things we're doing there is making sure that every student that takes Algebra 2 takes a TSI math right after they take the test. Because at the high school level with accelerated block, you can take Algebra 2 in the fall and you won't have math again until the second semester of your senior year. You have a whole year and a half not having math. And so we're making sure those students take TSI math right after they take Algebra 2, which is a big part of the TSI math class. And then this year we all read the Seven Mindsets curriculum, which is kind of like, I guess it's just another version of Capturing Kids' Hearts. I know that Sherilyn Hosker read it. Did y'all read it also? Several campuses read it. Our teachers loved it. We brought a speaker in. They spent a day with us talking about, and it's kind of a touchy-feely thing with teachers. Coming from me already. So that's something we're doing. One of the things we pull from that, 100% accountable, is one of the seven mindsets. We put that on our freshman shirts because we're taking a little bit of everything and we're training that throughout the year. We've already had counselors do two lessons on the set of mindsets with our teachers. And it's just taking care of their mental health, social well-being. Because if they're not happy, the kids aren't happy. So it's like somebody's already said in here several times. Our areas of focus, there's five of them there. And you can read our percentages. The main one I want to show you is the first one, CCMR. We were 67% 2 years ago. We improved to 78 last year, so we want to be 85 this year. And that's a big jump, but it's doable. And it's really our industry-based certifications, getting more of them, improving our TSI scores, as well as our AP scores. And I felt we had a little drop this year in AP scores, we still went up. So we shuffled some teachers in the master schedule and hopefully get more students in there. We recruited, and so hopefully with our AP scores and all these other things, we're gonna increase to 85% in CMR. 2 and 3 are both ELA, 1 and 2. So those are combined scores. You can see small percentages growth, but we wanna be realistic. I mean, these traditionally have been low scoring populations, and so we're just trying to every year increase them a little bit at a time. Those are big focus for us. Attendance, 95.8 to 96.5, what that looks like. 95.8 with our current population is 66 students being absent. To get to 96.5, we can have 55 or less. So that's a little bit of an improvement, 11 students at a big high school. I mean, you think it's easy, but it's really not. It's hard. Imagine having one kid at elementary is two kids at the high school because they have brothers or sisters there that they miss too. So it's very difficult to get them to come, especially at the high school level. We're working on that hard. Right now we're at 96.88. So we're doing well right now. We're going to try to keep it up. And then the last one, again, this is our growth measure. What got us this year was our seventh distinction was growth. And so we're working hard on that. We have to get a 77 to get an A. It's a converted score. So that's, you know, 63 to 77 is a big jump. But we feel like with our Algebra 1 team, our ELA 2 team this year, we're going to get to that mark. We're working hard on that. The DPA planning, we're sitting with teachers after every 6 weeks, planning like everybody else is doing with the growth trackers, and the teachers are turning it around to students, teaching them how to do it, so they're doing their own growth trackers. I've done walkthroughs, and teachers are actually doing that with students. And then they're teaching, and then they have a student come up there, and they're teaching, and they have another student come up. So that's how they're doing that at the high school level. So, do you have any questions for me?
You don't see making it to a state championship on your list? Maybe you kind of put that one back on.
There's so many that we have, but you know.
Oh, my God.
Get out of here. Okay.
I'm obviously just kidding.
I know you are.
You got to do a great job.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Sorry, I went over.
Thank you. Mr. Carr.
Good evening, Dr. Lowdy, and the board. Three areas of focus here for us is comparative growth. Of course, you've heard growth from, in the high school, it's from 8th grade math to Algebra 1, English 1 to English 2, and of course, growth in dead plus, speaking and writing for our EL kids, and so that's what we're working on. We did get a 99 on our score, but we did get a B in growth, and so in domain 2A, so we're fixing to make that into an A so we can be an all A campus.
You can.
The next area of focus is our distinctions. We earned 5 of 7, so of course we want to make sure that we take care of that and join our fellow campuses that had that great lunch.
Just throwing it out there. It was really great.
You always do it with such a straight face.
The motivation. I had good eyes, but I was pretty good too. But we are focusing on our advanced courses to our dual credit classes and AP courses, and so and focusing on AP participation and performance. And of course, because we are an early college high school, we also have that accountability component. And so making sure that we continue to meet all outcome-based measures in the access, attainment, and achievement. So our four areas of focus include, again, CCMR for us, making sure our kids are TSI ready, taking dual credit classes, completing their associate degree, getting certifications. And if they're not getting an associate degree, making sure that they certifications, following a coherent sequence, and so forth. And so AP as well, But as you can see, it's a short, small room to grow, but we're trying our best. Okay. Next one is increasing our master's level. So we do have, because we are compared to those 40 established early college high schools, we do have high master's levels to compete with, and so we're making sure we target those and have those discussions with the teachers and students using our Chardon ISD student growth tracking resources. Increased percentage of students taking AP tests, again, making sure we get the distinctions, and not only in social studies, but having those conversations with our English teachers for the language and the composition and the literature AP tests, world history as well, so making sure we get that distinction. And then making sure for DELPAS we're growing there. We would have missed the criteria for DELPAS score by one student. We had a 41. Let's call it. The criteria was 42, right? Before they lowered it to 36. And so literally when you talk about one student can hurt you, we would have been hurt by one student. So yeah, we're focusing on that. Any questions?
You know, one of the things that I think warrants another discussion for another day and on a different agenda was, we've kind of just mentioned in passing, was it goes back to listening to what your customer wants and the demand to be in this program, and stop me if I'm wrong, is exceeding the number of available slots. Mm-hmm. And at some point, whenever that is, I think that needs to be addressed. I think you got to listen to what your customer. Your customer is telling you that that's what they want, and we're not fulfilling that need, and that customer is going to go somewhere else. And again, that's a discussion for another day. But I'd ask folks not to forget about that.
Yeah, last year we had about 225 applicants. We did
for 100 slots.
Yeah, for 100 slots. So we made it.
So that tells you everything right there.
And that,
well,
and that
25 went to IB.
There's a lot. Yeah,
we lost all infrastructure planning, mm-hmm. building. I mean, just on and on, and stuff like that doesn't take time. And while we're maybe not moving as fast, they're going somewhere else, and they're not going to wait for us.
Mm-hmm. Anyway, students to select other campuses or other districts because they weren't accepted to our campus. Mm-hmm.
But I think it's Jake, you want to help me out here on the accountability portion of it? We're a very unique district. We thought of doing the early college, and I came in here with that thought of doing early college at all campuses. The way our kids take AP courses, dual, some of them don't want the dual enrollment. I came in here thinking all our parents would want that. They don't want that. They want the AP. Mm-hmm. They want the more rigorous. So it's a unique situation, and we can go back into it because then the whole accountability, we did this whole study last year, and it doesn't behoove this district to do the whole early college because they're already doing all of that and taking all of these courses. And in some cases, the parents want them in the AP. They don't want them just taking a dual enrollment.
And if I may speak for PHS and SHS, I mean, their dual credit programs and their AP programs aren't increasing and they're thriving. And so they're having to, I'm sure, hire more staff to accommodate those students.
In my mind, there's no question that there are other experiences that are similar to the AP, whatever, at other campuses. But I'm just looking, you know, it's all about data. That's all here. Well, the data.
But also,
the data I'm hearing is just 200 people who want this.
Then we have very specific outcome-based measures that he has to meet down to the number of at-risk students because the whole blueprint has changed for early childhood. Early college, high school, I have early childhood in my budget in my mind. But that's where he also struggles because we have a lot of wants, but the children that want in and want that, they don't meet the outcome-based measures. They don't meet the OBMs.
Yes, but going back to what Ricky was saying.
We'll lose our accreditation if we don't hit those OBMs.
No. Okay, so there's a certain percentage from 100 that we need to meet, right?
Out of all students. His entire school population has to get those OBMs.
Okay, what I'm getting at is that we're not going to stay 100 students forever. Am I correct?
We increased to 125 this past year.
I think I can handle, when we did the initial last year with the 225,
we took every single at-risk student, which is like part of the OBM for the measure, for the population, and so that raised the cap of students. So we literally took the maximum allowable students, where we could still meet the
47 at-risk.
Yeah, so we took the maximum amount of students we could, where we could still meet the minimum thresholds from TEA. And so, like, I think we are having a lot of kids that are interested in the program, but they're not the kids that fit what TEA is requiring for that program. So I think we have a good challenge there, because we have a lot of these programs that are comprehensive high schools. We just need to market these programs a little bit better on our part, you know, and saying like, hey, while yes, you may not be able to get a seat at SA3, you can still participate in these same programs for the most part, for as far as the core complete and things like that within our traditional high schools. And I think we could do a better job of marketing that.
Well, whatever that answer is, whatever that is, and I totally get that not everybody that applies is capable of that kind of work. I get that part of it. I just want to make sure, though, that if it's a marketing, if it's a discussion with a parent, whatever it is, that family who brings their child is interested in that program and is told they're not to be in that program, that somebody called marketing is having a discussion with them, saying we have a similar experience.
We have a slide.
I don't want them to go somewhere else.
We have a slide in the recruitment presentation for us that says that, you know, there are dual credit and AP programs available at the comprehensive high schools. You know, that's how I start off my
presentation.
The Sheridan ISD is the place to be. We have the three best high
schools. A lot of the customers.
No, I know. But I want to give them a reason
for that.
Right, I agree.
SA3 distinction, advanced Canada. That's what they want to do. They need that for their kid to be in there. So we got to figure that out. But anyway, it's a different topic.
Yeah, it's a different topic. I just.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Carr.
Thank you. You did a great job.
Okay. Now we go to B, discussion of credit by exam approval. Mrs. Williams.
Yes, thank you guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Enjoy your evening.
Thank you.
Can we take a little break?
Jake from State Farm.
This is Atina.
Sorry.
Mrs. Martinez, we apologize for that.
No, you're good.
We have to take a little break.
Good evening, Board of Trustees, Dr. Vidaldi. What you have in your plum folders in front of you are some sample credit by exams that were recently revised by some of our high school staff during the October 3rd through 5th. What these exams are the newly revised credit by exams. Part of Texas Administrative Code, there was an update for it that stated that the Board of Trustees shall approve a process to complete and review credit by exams to make sure to ensure that they meet the minimum requirement, that they are aligned to all assessable TEKS, that they have not been published or not publicly available. That's why they're not within your drive there on your iPad, because we can't make them publicly available. So if someone does open records, you can't. And we can see it. And they will only be administered in a secure environment under standardized testing conditions by a school district or an institute of higher ed. Also within this criteria, we have until the end of the 19-20 school year for this process to take place. That's kind of why we're bringing them now. It's a no later than the 19-20 school year before the first administered. So whatever exams we approve this month, if you choose to approve those exams, they'll be eligible to be first given out this year. Essentially, what these credit by exams mean is that if students have taken a course and maybe lost credit due to attendance, let's say they passed the course but lost credit, they can take this exam and score an 80% or higher without prior instruction, or 70% or above if they've already taken the course for course credit. I brought some of those samples. Those are actually the actual credit by exams teachers wrote October 3rd through 5th. You can see that they're very rigorous. So if a kid is scoring an 80% on those exams, they know their stuff as far as that content. The teachers did a phenomenal job. I got to give the high school principals credit. They lent us a couple of teachers for a few days. We went over the process, went over the minimum requirements, and that's more or less what those exams are looked like.
So we create them. We
yes. As an ISP, so we have multiple options. Currently, we have Texas Tech and the UT Austin exams that we could also choose to purchase. But then we also have local exams in the event that we need an exam for a credit by exam for, like, say, a student with a very special situation. Or an assessment that maybe Texas Tech or UT doesn't provide an assessment for, we have these assessments available. And depending on some of them, the success rate may be a little bit better with UT or Texas Tech, but really you could see, usually the local assessment is the easier assessment, but you could see that those assessments are very rigorous. So a kid's really gonna have to know the content in order to be able to get credit by those exams.
When you were from these universities, the prices went up.
Yes.
Yes, it's $35 a test. When children want to accelerate in the elementary and skip a grade level, it's $35 a test for all four core content areas. And House Bill 5, way back in the day, says we have to pay for it whenever someone wants to test. So I'll order a test at $35 a pop. They take the first one, they don't get to the 80. I just lost out on the other three. I have to send them all back.
So how many people even do credit by exam?
It depends on the subject area. There's some high-frequency credit by exams like physics where kids may struggle throughout the class, or sometimes they'll have a very rigorous college instructor and they'll want to take the high school for high school credit. They may have lost with the college credit where they didn't pass, but
like 100 kids?
Yeah, I would say probably 100 kids would be a fair estimate. A new requirement with this is Texas Administrative Code is that we actually have to present the data for all of these assessments annually to you. Because honestly, if you ask me as of today, how many kids took this specific exam last year, I probably can't replicate that data for you, to be honest with you, because it's really not a data collection process. So I think this is part of the state's way of saying, hey, this needs to be a more formal process than what districts are doing across the state right now, and we need to be able to monitor that. And oh, by the way, you need to revisit all the exams you have and make sure they meet the minimum requirements there. And so that's why we brought in a team of teachers to kind of look and revisit and create these exams. None of these exams in front of you were in existence prior to the October 3rd day. These were all created just newly for credit by exams.
So they don't fulfill that requirement?
They all fulfill the minimum accessible teach requirement of the credit by exam.
Any other questions or comments? Thank you, Mr. Zatsimas.
Thank you.
Student services, discussion of class size waiver plan. Ms. Garza.
Good evening, members of the board, Mr. Garcia, Dr. Vidaudi. Back in September, we did bring a class size waiver to you. We did have one classroom that did go over the 22-1 ratio at Hinojosa Elementary. We did have one other class at Benson Elementary, a first grade class, that did go with 22-1 ratio. And so we're asking for to be able to take a waiver to the state for that classroom. Okay. Any questions? Thank you.
Seven, business operation and finance. Some of these items were discussed at the BOF. So if you just want to give us a little recap, but I know there's some that we did not talk at all at BOF. So, okay, so like the first one, discussion of Bill Gray, spits of donation, that is an item that you discussed, and they're trying to do the little covering areas in the front side of the school. So,
yes, sir.
Anything else you need to add on that?
No. Just earlier today, we were excited to share the great news that Bill Gray is receiving a donation for the amount of $9,000. From their SPITZO. The funds are preferably for the covering of two different sections on the campus. The SPITZO did reach out to receive three proposals. The cost was roughly $18,000. So the company is willing to give a 50% discount as a price break as part of their community involvement initiative. So we believe that they have a student or someone that works for the company has a student in the campus. So. We'll be bringing this to the board meeting next week as a celebration, just like we do with Johnny Cherry Elementary last month.
And
And now we have B, update on construction projects. Mr. Corey. Ms. Kemp.
Sorry, okay.
But,
okay.
Is
that
our
situation?
I've got a water leak, so just to make the board aware, I've got to make a water leak
we'll
in front
of
the McLeish Center at the high school. I've got guys out there, but I just want,
okay.
I'll take any call.
In the water.
Come on, Mark.
So,
he's gonna be in the truck. He's gonna be in the truck with 60-degree weather. You know, outside.
But just want to let y'all know.
Thank you.
May not have water in the McLeish Library tomorrow morning till we get this fixed. But the big thing is right now, just trying to get off, and it is. There's a lot of water. You may see water on Sherry Road. Just
we've
got the city out there helping us. Finding the line, or we know the line, but finding the valve so we can shut it. It's been an ongoing situation since about 5:30, from right after.
That's a lot of water.
So, yes, it's been difficult to take care of. But we think that we found it and are going to shut it off and see how much we can dry overnight and get it repaired.
Okay. Construction projects.
Okay, so real quick, I just want to give you all an update. On the high school softball lighting, we've got all the poles up, it's looking real nice, and everything is ready, but we had one little situation, unfortunately, when we were lifting, or not we, but when the contractor was lifting the lights, they broke a few of the lights themselves, and they're already gone out to get them ordered, they had to remanufacture them. Within the next week or two, we should have them in, the three in, and then we're done.
What
so we'll be able to
three?
Light it up.
You mean three?
Three of the fixtures.
On one pole?
No, on like two different poles, three of the fixtures. When they were lifting them, they broke them.
That's funny. They do that for a living, right?
you would think.
Okay.
But if we needed to play a game, we would have light and everything. It's just what we don't want to do is we want to make sure it's all complete, and then we turn it on. But
nice.
You'll see the different aerials on these lights. We would like, once we get everything up and going, coach wants to turn them on at night, one night.
Get close to the... Yeah. No, get close to the...
the dugouts?
Yeah.
Go on your own, buddy.
Dugouts?
Over here?
Right there. Just go down the center to the concession.
Oh, concession.
Yeah, right there.
Yes.
You see the boards that are right there?
Yes.
No. Right there.
Where?
Behind the
stop.
Oh, right here? The backstop?
The backstop.
Yes. So
can
we're going to...
Can we get rid of those and put some new boards? Or
we're going to put new boards. We're also going to... if you go back... David, can you zoom out again, show the outfield? The fence is off in the outfield. We're going to go back and put a metal fence. We're going to do this to both softball fields. In the next 2 months, we're going to do this one first, and then we're going to go to Pioneer and do that one too. Just kind of let you all know.
Pioneer? The brand new fence?
Their softball field. They want the metal.
I know they want. I'm just saying that's a brand new fence.
They want the metal, so they're going
to
get
them. Well,
it's a brand new fence, Mark.
We're trying to.
It's 3 years old, brother.
Five years old.
Fine.
Fine.
Yeah, I mean.
But we can use the fence itself, Mr. Longoria. We're going to do it in-house. The fencing itself, we'll keep, and we'll use that. We're just going to put, we'll use the same poles and everything. We're just going to attach metal to it and keep the, get
the. Yeah, but the metal's very expensive on a square foot basis. Very expensive.
I don't know how much we're talking about.
$2,000.
Still, but the edges. Who approved that?
We're
just doing comparable. You just want.
I just wanted to be comparable. That's
yeah, but I mean,
if we start being comparable,
yeah, we'll never
we're
finish.
Never
you'll never gonna finish.
We gotta do a new SHS.
$2,000.
Yeah, it's not. It's a philosophical thing.
Because they have a hurricane.
Yes, they
have. Go ahead.
And this one's old, and we just.
Oh, like that's more than what you thought.
Let's discuss
it. We'll discuss
it.
No,
I'm
sure.
Because we're going to start being comfortable.
Yeah, it's not the amount. To me, it's a.
We're going to discuss this, and we'll bring.
That's a big discussion we're going to have, and
that's a brand new school. Spent over $55 million, though. And we're taking stuff up. We just put up 5 years ago.
This is SA3. I'm sorry. This is SHS. But
yeah, I'm talking with you. That's,
I get you.
Yes, that just seems odd to me.
Okay.
That's a want, not a need.
Yes, sir.
Can you put something in here?
the okay.
Next one is.
During the meeting, all he's going to do is just sit in the back.
Yeah, go ahead.
What are right here?
Fuel tank, the fuel tank insulation, we are moving forward with that. David, if you want to show the aerials. This week we will be pouring the first slab, and that's the slab where the tank's going to go. Once we get that poured, then we're going to come back. We're planning on starting next week to get the other two pads on the sides and pouring those out. So then when the tanks get in November, it's just place the tanks, run the conduit, run the power, and then we should hopefully get it going.
Is there any indication that it won't be done on
rain?
At this point, well, no.
It's just rain bunching.
The tanks and everything have been ordered, and that's the biggest thing.
You know, I will say that is because of the way you take your pictures, that you drive through there all the time, you don't think about it, but you know, we have a really pretty M&O area. That is really nice.
It's
and the way they keep up with it, Mark, like the bus is all lined up. I love to see that like that. Nice, neat, clean.
They work hard at it, I know that.
No new fences. No, I'm just kidding.
Not necessary.
Okay.
All right, so next one then is, want to discuss is the installation of the cafeteria equipment at Sherry North Junior High. That has been installed, and just want to show you all what the equipment looks like.
Oh, wow. That's nice.
This is regarding that $70,000 grant
that they got.
That's
yes.
Nice.
And such a vendor and stuff.
Yes, sir.
Yay.
And that was a bit of a challenge to get it installed, but staff did that.
Nice and clean.
Yes, nice and clean.
And red.
And red. And then the last item, of course, is the, you know, also we've got the three bids, and then it is an agenda item. We'll discuss.
Yes. Okay. Thank you, Mark.
Yes.
Yeah, I was just kidding about the
I wasn't, man.
Just trying to keep you in your toes, Mark.
Oh, I know that. Hey, double check the price.
Yeah.
Item C was an item that we discussed at BOF.
Yes, sir. We did receive, this is for Hinojosa Elementary, an HVAC replacement project. We received three proposals for the project. The lowest price and the highest ranked company came in at $1,572,000. You can go to the $545. So just, I don't know if Mr. Rivera, put in front of you a little spreadsheet of a document of like what our plan was. Originally, whenever we got with our architect who's here, if you have any questions. We were looking at an estimated cost of $1.4 million. Prior to that, we had approved the budget with the Forsyth Capital Project amount of $1,192,000. The highest ranked contractor proposal came in over $1.5 million. With the architectural fees and everything of 6%, we would be looking at having to take a budget amendment to the board as well if we wanted to move forward with this.
Okay. First of all, when you say highest ranked contractor proposal, I know that we did this 70%, 20, 10, whatever. Who's the low bidder?
They are, Air Cool Tech.
They are the same one.
Yes, so everybody actually has, if you can go to the bids, or to the three companies, it was Air Cool Tech, Central Air and Heating, and Holchimont. They've all worked with the district. They all have great relationships with the district. So the only difference, if anything, was price. And Air Cool Tech came in at the lowest with the same amount of days needed, 180 days. And right now what we're looking at is a base bid.
So. Correct me if I'm wrong, but the reason is because what you mentioned that 1.4, you guys are pretty sure that that's what it would be, but the premium is because there's so much business that people can afford to put.
Yes, the demand right now is out there. There's a lot of work. Go ahead.
Yeah, it's totally the market how it is right now. Yeah.
I'm still behind the 1.4, but I know there's a lot of work out there for the contract. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Can we negotiate that?
Yes, sir. Is that something that we're currently
I mean, try
from the highest ranked person. We're gonna see if we can knock that cost a little lower. Keep the same specifications, the same expectations, but to tighten up as they can a little bit, give us a best and final offer.
Somebody have a calculator. What's the sum of all the totals if you add all the alls? You still end up with Emmett a little bit?
I think there was a typo on alternate four about, or it was a credit, right, wasn't it?
We need to go back and
look at alternate four.
And alternate four. Because if you look at the other two, we just didn't want to get ahead, make sure that we're all on the same page. But we do see that there's a big discrepancy with that alt four,
yeah.
So we need to go back and talk to them on that one.
Well, I mean, is there any?
Because right now we're not planning on doing any of the alternates. That's not included.
But you're asking what would the price be?
What we're talking about right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, I'm saying if we decided to say, hey, we want the alternates, what's the sum total of?
Are they really the lowest?
The lowest. Let me have a calculator. I mean, just
cool.
David, you guys are just. I mean, you stand up the same.
Even though he says the 154,000 is not necessarily.
You know what?
A real
Central
number.
Air is a lot less expensive than air cool.
It would come out, but I know that we talked to today was that there was a credit, right?
We think there's an issue with the 154, but until we confirm it, we don't. It's hard to say because the other two are giving credit.
They're
so
giving credit.
We don't.
Because that one had to do with climate tech, right?
Right.
We think there's an obvious mistake there.
But what is alternate four?
It's another type of controls company than the base bit.
Climate tech controls.
Climate tech.
It's another type of control.
Controls, yes.
Is it?
I suspect, and this is just my opinion, that is the cost that he got from climate tech for the controls portion. And he misunderstood the line item. Instead of comparing the 150 versus, let's say, 200 from ALC, he should have put 50.
Yeah.
But he went ahead and put that is the only explanation I can.
So that makes sense.
So can we have that information for?
Oh, before we
yes.
come to you on Monday,
yes.
We'll have
so
all that clarity.
So is it you all intend to recommend all?
If anything, depending wherever we can get a savings, yes, which could be in alt four, which would just be a different control.
Okay.
It's just the
control
the interface with how we deal with the units.
Yeah, and I get what you're saying. In other words, he probably forgot to discount the existing control cost to.
I thought like maybe we can do it.
Yes.
I think we can take care of like alternate three if we want out of our budget.
What is that alternate three?
Test and balance. It's a test and balance, right?
Yeah. So alternate three is to have the test and balance contractor to go check some sensors that are located above the system.
Ah.
The base bit scope of work includes the replacement of everything that has more than at least 15 years old. The lifespan of expected from those sensors is 23 years, so there's still some useful life on there. That's why we wanted to put that as an option, because more than likely all the sensors are in good shape, but we want somebody to go and check it out. Yes.
Right now, our focus is to talk with Aircool Tech, get the clarification, get a best and final offer, and if we're not satisfied and that 154 is real, then we're going to go with the second lowest, and that's, you know, and then we're going to do the same thing.
But you don't
want to
do it
clarity
on the presumption that we want to go with all four. If you're not going to go all four, it didn't matter.
Of course.
Right. I think it's a base bit.
You want new controls.
What do y'all want? Do y'all want?
Right now, what we're looking at is the base bid, and that it was going to be up to discussion today because, honestly, the only thing I've been thinking about is hearing you all out about the budget amendment. It's a big amount that the board's going to have to approve.
Yeah, but the alternative to that is don't do the project. That's the project's going to be done.
Yeah.
Well, we're going to push back in regard to the price, but I mean, I'm speaking for myself.
all I heard was, and we need to do the ACU.
We do.
So, you know, so I'm just trying to figure out if we're gonna do it.
So as we get clarification on the alternates, if they're needed, then we will have them added to the price, and we're gonna clarify all the prices, and Monday we'll have a recommendation.
Yeah, because like Julio was saying, the other two look like they have a discount, and then the other one is just an actual price.
Because the only one that I'm thinking, because alternate two was the other controls, right?
Yes, train, but they did not bid.
Okay, so.
Alternate two was.
We'll get those clarifications for us.
Yes.
So that we make a sound decision.
Yes, sir.
And as far as the budget amendment.
No.
Because you gotta work that out, right? I mean,
or we negotiate to the original 1.4 that is estimated. If it's possible.
Yeah, yeah, I mean.
Well, they can try, that's their job.
It never hurts to have a discussion.
Exactly.
And then the architectural fees are.
Negotiable,
right?
You all in the box on that one.
The person who deal with that is not here, that's Rudy.
Okay, we go to item D, any other discussion? Discussion to request for proposal 1920-4, self-funded plan, third-party administrator, GPA, jurisdiction, we prefer provider organization, PPO, network access. And again, this was another item that was discussed with the insurance committee. So if you just want to briefly touch base.
Yes, and Mr. Roger Gard, our consultant here, is well to answer any questions that the rest of the board might have. But we did discuss this at the insurance committee meeting. We reviewed and evaluated four proposals, which were submitted specifically for the district's medical plan. We're planning on completing an additional market analysis after discussing this at the insurance committee meeting, which should be completed in approximately 2 weeks' time. Once completed, we want to run an additional evaluation on the market analysis, bring the data analysis to the insurance committee, and hopefully bring a recommendation to the special board meeting for approval. In the meantime, we're planning on putting the plan together to ensure that enrollment gets going. We need to get that going and is completed in time for the end of November. So just in a nutshell, we have three companies, if anything, that we're really gonna probably do the evaluation on, which is Freights, who is the incumbent of our medical plan, and Blue Cross Blue Shield, and UMR through United Healthcare Choice Plus. Those are right now in the discussion and consideration of completing a market analysis and seeing what the impact would be specifically on discounts. Not really comparing the administrative fees, more so on the entire program when it comes to claims that are being submitted throughout the year. So we will complete this analysis hopefully in the next 2 weeks, come back to the committee, then go to the board, and hopefully have a provider, you know, from by then. So that's pretty much a summary of what we discussed and what we're doing.
Mark, Furman Center.
Yes, sir.
Roger.
No,
lots of
Center. I've got a water leak.
Hey, remind me to tell you about a joke that I saw last night with Antuve between you and.
Yeah, I know, I saw it too.
Just in case.
It's a lot more different.
Yeah. Just in case I forget, so I just accept.
Thank you.
Okay, so we went out for bids. We were with Frady's, and we end up with Frady's again, mm-hmm. Right? A little bit.
Pretty much, yes.
Pretty much. So the rate from what we had to what we have now is what? The same?
There's no change in the rate.
There's no change in the rate. So the rate is the same.
The rate has.
Okay. On the procurement process, when we went out to gather these individuals out here, the procurement process, there was a census that was missing from one of these contenders up there, or somebody basically was concerned about not having the census out, and we finally put the census out, and I think everybody was bidding. Was there a concern in the middle of the way that we did an addendum to make sure that everybody had the census of our teachers?
They wanted a census in Excel. We typically provide it in PDF. And a lot of them wanted the names gender, zip code of the individuals and
date of birth.
And it kind of ran right to the PHI information. And what I told staff was they're harvesting information. That's what they're doing. They sell the data. Okay, why cover it up? And it's okay if you wanted to give it to them. However, it's a small school district. I say small, pardon me. It's not a small school district, but there's a lot of people know each other. So whenever you release prognosis, diagnosis like that, it actually could target the person. So you can actually be held liable for releasing PHI information, particularly when you're releasing the date of birth and particularly the initials of the zip codes. But where they needed the data was on the stop loss. They don't really need it on the TPA. The TPA is very simple. We're just asking you what does it cost to administer a third-party administration program per claim. But on the stop loss, we released that, and the stop loss was not extended, but the due date is not until the end of the month, because we need they'll need actual claims data up until the last possible day before they sign the application.
But this is a general question. Uh-huh. Why would somebody that basically wants to be a third party administrator for the district, mm-hmm. which third party administrators is basically the guy that interacts in between us and the
right
either the RXs or the doctor, right?
Right.
The question is,
I hit you with the second time.
So, I guess my question, why would they have a concern or need of a census and basically say that they would not bid because the census would not provide it on somebody like this?
You know, I can speculate all day long. Again, I go back to harvesting. Okay, they want the data, you know, they want it in a specific format. Particularly when it comes to name, gender, we won't release.
So your answer is there's no need for them.
There's
to
no
need
them for it. There really
okay.
is no need.
Before people didn't think there was a need for it.
Blue Cross submitted, and I mean they were aggressive. These other two submitted; they were pretty aggressive. There was. I think everybody was aggressive.
And really, their bids, if I'm not mistaken, Mark, is basically how much work they're going to be doing for the 1,300 plus employees that we have, right? How much work are they going to be answering phone calls?
Yes.
That's what they're going to be charging for.
Cutting the check, writing the claim, cutting the check.
That's basically the third party administration.
That's it.
That's exactly what he's going to be doing. Okay.
They give you a check registrar at the end of each month, right? 2 week cycle. And then you look at what we do, Hyman does. And then they pay it off of there. If we don't contest any of that, that's probably the reason.
But they do want some of the data to look at possible claims histories and ages and things like that. They're not just basing their fixed cost on the ages of the employees. I mean, they're using that information to also, you know, give you some stop loss attachment points and all that. But it's the same information everybody else has.
Yeah. But always remember, I stay with harvesting because carriers do it, TPAs don't. TPAs just tell you how much we're going to pay. That's it. Or how much you're paying. They quote it. Insurance companies harvest the information because it's geographic. They can do it in La Jolla, compare it to Mission, to compare it to Sherland, to McAllen, and so on and so forth. That's all they're doing.
Okay.
It wasn't the second base with the two that's standing next to the other guy.
No. My next question is basically on these individuals that are third-party administrators. Do they have local representation? Do they use local agents?
Do they use
local agents? In other words, do they have local agents that they say, okay, I'm going to pick Mark's insurance agency to come and help me and do the enrollment?
We don't, unless the board specifically says, no, in this case, no. Unless the board specifically chooses one, but then they have to pay them for that.
Sure. But in the beautiful world of insurance that is so nice, it's beautifully put together for the rest of the entities like us, it's your understanding and everybody's understanding that these guys are working directly with us all the time, right. not using local agents.
Right. That's the way the bid specs are, and that's the way the rules of engagement are. So we actually post it, we tell them that information for compensation, because quite frankly, we've never had that service here. So.
Now, if one of them is awarded, we can't control if they do hire.
That's a problem.
Yeah.
We can't control that if they do hire a local agent.
That's a problem.
Why is that a problem?
Huh?
Why is that a problem?
Because it's a... Because?
Well, you can have, you can always have stipulation in your agreement that there'll be no agent compensation or third or fourth party compensation involved.
But that's in the contract.
Yes.
It makes sure that...
It is in the contract. We, in fact, I insisted to put it on there unless you insist not to put it in there. So, but if you all agree, then we stipulate it in the contract specifically so that there's no compensation.
We did that. Payment.
Yes.
We've done that in the, with the past contract.
And we did that on this one, too.
But we don't write a check, though.
Yeah, we're not.
Share it on ISD. But, like, if Freight's writes a check, that's Freight's. That's all there. That's Freight's business.
If they do that.
But we have stipulated that Sharon and ISD's not going to write a check. Sure.
No, but okay. Don't we stipulate in the contract to make sure that they...
There is no compensation, is what I'm saying. So our contract is very, very specific. It says that we will not compensate anyone, you know, with what you got here. Now, if you want to go out and hire a marketing guy in Dallas, or that's your problem, but we can't control that. But here locally, there's nobody in these proposals. In fact, we looked at all of them from option one to four, and we couldn't find it.
Roger, I have a quick question. I haven't to do, and this is my last question, I haven't to do with third party administration. When I was city mission, we got rid of our third party administrator that basically administered everything for San Antonio. And, is that we did away with them and basically we had our own staff doing the third party administration work.
Okay.
And it just, we had some savings there. Is it possible to do that?
Sure. I've told a couple of large school districts that they should do that as much as they pay for TPA services or carrier services.
Okay, thank you.
So it's a great idea. In fact, I would encourage you to do it, but I mean, you always have to look at ways how you can cut your costs, and that's one minor step you can take.
Okay.
So
Mark
staff,
just got a $300,000 rate.
But normally we deal directly with the company. So I guess that I guess it's clarified that we normally, like with medical, we deal directly. Like in this case, right now. If we have an issue, we call Freight. So it's, you know, the employee will come to Maria Fuentes, who's the insurance specialist, and we also have her backup, Janelle, or myself, too. We have a problem, we call the insurance company, and we deal with them directly if they have questions on their bill.
That's this guy's work.
But we don't. But what we don't do is we don't write the checks or cut the checks or process the bill.
That's my concern. That we're doing a lot of the work of the TPA does.
But all we're doing is we're just being the intermediary.
That's my own opinion. I don't know.
The staff, though. But we only call if the staff comes to us with any concerns or anything. They may have a question on a bill. So then we'll get, between staff and ourselves, we'll call the TPA and we'll say, okay, explain this to us. Or can you go back and review this bill, make sure it was processed properly, it was paid properly. Sometimes a bill, you know, won't get processed, right? So it didn't get processed, and then now the employee gets it. They come to us. We scan it, we send it to the TPA, and they reply, oh, you know what, we never got the bill, we have it now, we'll process it, and we'll pay it off.
This is the way I see it, Mark. The way I see it is that the fox, okay, is basically receiving a phone call in the hen house from the head rooster and saying, okay, hey, take care of my chicks. Come on. Okay. Yeah, do you understand what I'm getting? In other words, we're telling an insurance company to take care of us from an insurance company. That these guys drink coffee together up in the 30th floor in New York. I am being serious. I'm not trying to add a little laughter in there, but.
But in this one, there it's just us, and in this case, Freight. So that's it. There's nobody in between us.
Roger knows what I'm talking about. if there's questions.
And I understand what you're saying. What we've always known from day one is they always wanted direct contact. So if you have an employee that has a dependent that has a condition that they can't understand, and we've had that. We've had conditional individual, and I need to be careful how I say that. But we intercede because they're restricted, they're experimental issues, okay? So sometimes we say, yes, it looks like it's a payable claim, or no, it's not a payable claim. So we intercede, but for us to write, 10,000 checks is what we're averaging, about 9,000, 8,000 checks a month? It's what we're paying an administrator to do, and basically comply with federal law.
This is separate than our voluntary product, where we do have the agents in there.
Are you talking about, in other words, the fully insured company, we would just write a check to them and they would take care of everything for us? Is that what you're comparing it to?
Yeah, basically us as a self-insured guy is basically going to be taking care of our employees against the insurance company. In other words, he's asking for some type of medicine that does not fall under, because they give you a checklist. They basically, these are the 10 pills that you can take. These are the 10 aspirins that you can take, right?
Right.
And this guy cannot take these 10. He can take the 11th one.
Right.
Okay? So this insurance committee, and really that's what the insurance committee is supposed to be doing. This insurance committee sits down and says, okay, this guy cannot take aspirin A through aspirin 10. He can take aspirin 11, but aspirin 11 is going to cost us $15, $20 more.
Right.
Okay? And it doesn't matter who it is, because you don't put names out there, even in public meetings. But the insurance committee says, okay, yes, let's go ahead and approve that. They basically write the check for him to get his medicine. Our part of his $10,000 aspirin. There's a process that we need to start learning how to do, because it's my understanding that.
So are you saying we should administer as a district?
As a district, as a part administrator ourselves.
So we would probably need about 20 employees.
No, you need about 5 dedicated.
Well, dedicated, fully loaded.
To cut checks, to be licensed,
yeah,
to adjudicate claims,
to do
ERISA documents, to do all that stuff. I mean, you're talking about designations.
You make a valid point, but you also have to get your own separate server, because you can't use the district server. It has to be EDI compliant.
The logistics of all this is very technical, but all I'm getting at, is it possible, that was my last question, I didn't want to make it this long.
I'm sorry,
That's okay, Roger. But is it possible for us to handle something like that with 1,300 plus employees?
It's possible.
He gave you 15 minutes.
I'll answer that.
I understand what you're saying, but I don't. That would be, would probably be back up at half a million bucks, I think.
And I know, just for what it's worth, I know in the past, and maybe even before you, we've had the same discussion, right? And to the extent that you can conclude that you can do it cheaper, well, yeah, maybe you can. Go back, if it's 4 or 5 people, you're at the same number. So let's say that's a push, you break even. But then there's capital investment of whatever it's going to take to do that. But on top of that, it's a transfer of risk.
There's liability.
It's a transfer of liability from this process. Is it worth it to you to save, I don't know, pick a number, $50,000, and have an insurance committee and have people involved? You know, maybe at the 900, whatever number is at the end, the 760, maybe it makes sense. But just on the surface, it doesn't make sense to me. And if we want to analyze and discuss down the road, certainly like any other topic, it's worthy of discussion. As it pertains to what we're trying to accomplish here quickly, I don't think we have time. We have another market analysis that the insurance committee is asking them to do with respect to the negotiated rate with providers. And we have an enrollment in order to get to January 1.
It was just a couple questions that I had.
Well, we can do those just for due diligence is we can maybe look at some districts that might already be doing something like that in for the future.
Thank you.
Just to kind of get an idea of how
and
it works.
And one of the districts is our neighboring district, and I'm not going to say which one, but it can be to your
east or
right or
west.
East or west.
And I think part of the analysis, let's find out who's doing it, but you know, the fact pattern for apples has got to be exactly the same.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, the fast track is trying to get the market analysis quickly so that
this is after that.
Yeah, it's
the market analysis first, and then we'll
thank you. It was just a couple questions. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, gentlemen.
It's always good to think outside the box, man.
We go to item E, discussion of review of RFP 18-19-14 voluntary products. Mr. Gonzalez and Ms. Dorth.
Yes, sir. As discussed at the BOF committee meeting and the insurance committee meeting, administration is going to recommend next Monday to renew RFP 18-19-14 for one additional plan year for all voluntary products.
No changes.
Incumbents. No changes. We procured this last year. We were assured a 3-year rate guarantee. We're satisfied with the carriers and our agents, and we plan to stick with it.
So, okay. Go. Thank you. Any other questions? Item F, discussion to purchase Project Gateway computer equipment, another item that was discussed at BOF.
Yes. One of the positive outcomes from House Bill 3 was additional funding that we received in the career and technical program. So keep in mind, we have to spend a 55% allocation requirement specifically for CTE, which is around $5.5 million, just so you know. Because of this infusion, Mrs. Nava has been conducting some needs assessments. She had to leave. But the reason we're bringing this item to you is because it's over $50,000 worth of technology equipment. So she's planning on replacing a couple of labs and a couple of classrooms. If you have any questions, David is here because he's the one who actually went out and procured it.
Their custom computer is a lot more expensive than the norm. For the PLTW, the engineering courses have been taken. They use Autodesk, the software. Requires a lot more high-intensity computers, so they're more expensive.
But they cost about $20?
About $2,000. Yeah, they're out there. We usually pay half or less than half.
Any other questions? Item G, discussion to purchase Chromebooks and desktops from RFP 18-19-46, Technology Supplies and Equipment. Mr. Culberson, Mr. Lewis.
Yes, sir. As discussed at the BOF committee meeting, we're ready to implement our annual computer replacement program through the technology department. This will also need board approval. David, do you want to touch base on it?
Yes, we're looking at purchasing another 633 Chromebooks and 203 desktops. The Chromebooks are all basically going at the elementaries or to the elementary campuses, listed on the following page. The 203 desktops will be primarily at the secondaries and the administration. We've kind of lapsed a little bit on the administration computers, so we really need to take care of that area.
Any other questions or discussion? Item H, discussion of budget amendments that were also discussed at BOF.
Hein, if you want to touch base real quick on the summary sheet.
Yes, sir. Just so once again, this is a budget amendment. It is touching our fund balance, but it's just for the rollover of accounts that we didn't pay in the 18-19 year. There's our construction projects and also some of the vehicles, band equipment that wasn't paid out in 18-19. So a total of $942,224.
So just kind of look forward. We got the 200. We have the 942, we got the 450, right? Mm-hmm. We got 100 less kids. Mm-hmm. What else am I missing?
Well, let's just stop right there.
We actually good news coming next month.
Got it. I saw it.
What? We got 100 kids back?
No, funding wise.
Can we get an award? What do they call it? The Gatsby? So on the purchasing of the Pioneer scoreboard, I know that there was there's some funds coming in, right?
Not right now. We're working on
inquiry.
We're going to touch base and see if we've had any inquiries on the sponsorships.
as agreed. Has anybody just anybody call or not?
Hmm?
Has anybody showed interest? Anybody spoken to Dr. Nolan?
Hmm?
Somebody's gonna talk to the doctor.
Can I assign you?
Huh?
Alyssa was.
Can I
assign
you to do that?
Alyssa was the one gonna hit that up, so we
yes.
just need to check with her later to see.
Okay.
And then
yeah, because yeah, there's also the cost of moving the school board.
Okay. Item I, discussion of investment portfolio. Ms. Gonzalez, another
yes.
item we'll discuss during BOF.
As discussed at the BOF committee meeting, the finance department is recommending to add an additional pool to our portfolio, which will assist us in diversifying our funds when needed. With the market changes, we feel adding one more will provide us another avenue to secure our funds with pool collateralization. So the name of the pool is Lone Star Investment Pool. There is no cost to the district. We can have a dollar, $10, $5 in there. It's just another avenue that, another tool in our toolbox, basically, just because the way the market has been working, with rates going down.